Welcome, everybody. My name is David Brashear. I'm the director of the Muscarelle Museum of Art. It's wonderful to have all of you with us today. As you know, this is our fall special program for Muscarelle members. And I want to just take a moment now to thank all of you for your support of the museum, for being active in our programs and coming to see our exhibitions. We really enjoy having you as part of the family. So of course, our guest speaker for the afternoon is Elaine Ruffolo, good friend of the Muscarelle Museum, very good friend. Elaine is an art historian. She's taught art history with a number of university programs, including Syracuse and Stanford, and has led tours through Italy for a wide variety of groups over the years. Her firm, Art History Encounters, offers online courses, travel programs, and much, much more. I know all of you enjoy Elaine's lectures. It's wonderful to have her with us today. So please join me in welcoming Elaine. Elaine, you're on.
All right, let me just share my screen, David. I'm ready to go. And let's get something beautiful up there for everyone to look at. Excellent, thank you so much. A big thank you to all of you. Thank you, David, for inviting me to speak to the Muscarelle. It's always a pleasure. I feel quite privileged to have had such a long time relationship with the museum and of course its members. And I'm coming to you from Florence, Italy. Here it's 8 p.m. and my cat has settled in for a nice talk on the mosaics of Ravenna. And I'm excited to present them to you. Now, this is quite a dense presentation, so I'm gonna jump right into the materials. I want you all to get up close to your screen so you can enjoy these beautiful images that I prepared for you. I'll go quite quickly in the beginning, getting us through the early Christians. And then once we get into the monuments of Ravenna, I'm gonna slow it down. And of course I call this presentation Ravenna, the Twilight of the Roman Empire. I realize that's a romantic name, but it's an appropriate title for this period of a little town in Ravenna that saw the glory days for just about 200 years at the very end of the Roman Empire. Gibbon wrote in his epic work, The Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire, he said, "Of all the Roman emperors, it will seldom be necessary to even mention the name Honorius. He was indeed lazy, boastful, and insignificant. And he was really one of the worst of all the Roman rulers. He was a coward and he sat by and looked on languidly while his country fell in ruins around him." So why do I bring him up? Because he did make one major decision for which the world owes him a debt of gratitude. In the year 402, fearful of being overrun by barbarian hordes that were roaming at will over his domains, he moved the capital of the Roman Empire from Rome to Milan. And Rome was a dangerous place. There's no natural defenses. And he chose Ravenna, which I'm showing you here, which is on the northern Adriatic coast of the Italian peninsula. And really for a brief and dazzling moment, Ravenna was, I guess, an unlikely refuge from a world that was falling apart, while ageless monuments in Rome were crumbling everywhere. Ravenna became crowded with sumptuous palaces, churches, streets, monuments, beautiful buildings. And this is just a taste of what we're going to get into. As Ravenna was the capital of the Western Empire on the Italian peninsula, at the same time, or I should say a little bit later, it will become the capital in the West for the Eastern Byzantine Empire. So it offered a kind of refuge of luxury and splendor, a return to antique civilization. This small town rising up against what must have been a relentless sea of barbarians. There's no place better than to really understand this waning of the Roman Empire, the twilight of the Roman Empire, than in the capital of the Western Roman Empire, Ravenna. Now, let's take a look. How did this all come to be? And certainly Ravenna is tied to the decline of the Roman Empire and the beginning of the early Christian world. And to understand that, we need to go back to the world of late antiquity. And here is Rome at its greatest extent, which I think is fascinating. So let's read this map together. And you can see, of course, the Roman Empire begins in Rome. And I like this map because you can see that Rome is in the center of the Mediterranean. The word Mediterranean comes from the term mede, terra, the middle of the middle of the earth. And of course, Rome will grow from Roma to include, of course, the whole Italian peninsula. And then the Romans made their money by conquering their neighbors, taxing the heck out of them, and then turning them into Roman citizens. So by the time we get to the second century after Christ, you can see that the Roman Empire has clearly overextended its borders. We've got Rome beginning here in some of the British Isles. Lusitania is, of course, Portugal. Mauritania here, this is today Morocco, all the way through Africa, Northern Africa, into Egypt, of course, Antony and Cleopatra, then up and around to this far-flung region of Judea, which becomes of all importance, up and around Mesopotamia, Dacia, Germania, and this is the greatest extent. So this shows us the Roman Empire really in its last act, and it begins to crumble and will eventually fall. Okay, why? Well, for both external and internal reasons. Number one, it got too big to control the borders. And very soon those borders will become porous and we start to see barbarians coming in through the, what's a barbarian? A barbarian is someone that doesn't speak Latin or Greek. Comes from the term babblers. Then the Romans were desperate for more recruits for their army and they begin to recruit barbarians to defend against the barbarians, which is not gonna work. Then the military begins to pay allegiance to the military leaders, to the generals rather than to the emperors. And we start to see the corruption of Rome from the inside out. And of course, in that far-flung region right here of Judea, during the reign of Augustus, a child was born named Jesus of Nazareth. Okay, this idea of Christianity will help lead to the crumbling of course, the Roman Empire. Now, what we know about Jesus comes from the Gospels, which are religious documents that were written just about a generation after the death of Christ. And we know from the Gospels, Mark, John, Luke, and Matthew, that according to Christian belief, God's kingdom was coming and you could attain it by emulating Jesus Christ. Okay, those are the basics of Christianity, preaching the abandonment of earthly concerns, love thy neighbor, and of course, compassion, but above all, one God, monotheistic. And that will not sit well with the Romans eventually. And it didn't sit well with the authorities of Christ's own religion. And eventually, Christ was crucified in 33 AD, a punishment so degrading that no Roman citizen was allowed to be crucified. And according to the early Christians, Christ overcame death. After 3 days, he rose, which is called, of course, resurrection. Now, I'm not here to give you a religious lesson, but all of this will have quite a bit to play when we get to the mosaics of Ravenna. So the spread of Christianity was really thanks to Christ's disciples. And they spread the word. Peter made it to Rome. At first it spread quite slowly, and then it got a big boost with somebody named Saul of Tarsus, who in 35 AD is going to head off. His post-conversion name is, of course, Paul. And he insisted that non-Jews could convert to Christianity as well, that salvation was guaranteed for both Gentiles, non-Jews, as well as Jews. And he was a tireless missionary, and he traveled. Look at these adventures of Paul. I think this is astonishing throughout the known world. He travels throughout the Roman Empire until, of course, he is killed in the persecutions under Nero. But just looking at this, you understand that the spread of Christianity was relatively easy, thanks to Paul, but also for a few reasons. One, there was a common language, and the common language throughout the empire was Greek. Realize that most people think it's Latin, but that's not the case. Greek. Paul is speaking Greek as he's making his way, writing, preaching to the Corinthians, to the Athenians, etc. Then, something to always keep in mind, that the Roman roads of the empire were very easily traveled. So communication, you know, like the internet today, things, communications, new ideas. And importantly, Christianity was appealing to the lower classes, the poor, the marginalized. Christianity offered salvation to everyone with no class distinctions, you know, emphasizing mutual aid and charity and freedom and an afterlife. And I think that was quite appealing to the initial converts who would convert down here in Judea. The Jews, and then later on the Christians, or excuse me, the pagans will convert to Christianity. And because of Paul, we start to find by the end of the first centuries, there were Christian communities in most cities in the Roman Empire. It was quite successful. Now, ordinarily, the Romans do not care what religious belief you have. You can worship any god or goddess that you want, as long as first you pledge allegiance to Mother Rome. That was necessitated. The Christians were seen as secretive. They were thought of as threatening to public order because they refused to sacrifice to the Roman gods. Therefore, they met resistance almost immediately, and there were persecutions in 64 under Nero, 250, 257, and 303. Because they were seen as traitors to the state. This is a romantic image. I found this on the internet. I thought you would find it entertaining. Of course, this is supposed to be Nero, who's pointing forward to send these Christians off to be eaten by the lions in the Colosseum, which actually didn't happen. But it's an interesting illustration. In any case, during these persecutions, surely there were martyrdoms. A martyrdom is killing someone for their belief. And just showing you a few of these, this is poor St. Andrew on St. Andrew's cross. Dropping down on the left, there's St. Lawrence, who's grilled alive. In the center is going to be St. Stephen, who is stoned alive. And here's poor Santa Polinare, who has her teeth pulled out. Yuck. All of this is grisly and violent, and it was supposed to squelch Christianity by sending these people off to their martyrdom. But actually, it may have helped boost Christianity, because the Romans must have thought, hey, maybe these people know something that we don't know. And why are they going off so happily to their death? They knew that there was a better life in the afterlife. Certainly the worst persecutions under the Christians was under Nero and Caligula and later Diocletian. And it was under Nero that the two main saints of Romans in the Roman Christianity, Peter and Paul, will be killed. Okay, that means that Christianity at this point is illegal. And the art that comes from this period, because it's illegal, will of course be in the cemeteries or what we call the catacombs. And I just took us down into a catacomb. So Christian imagery goes underground, literally. And you end up with cemetery. This is a really interesting image, I think, because if you've not been to a catacomb, next time you come to Rome, you must visit one. They're fascinating. This is a street, so there's all kinds of passageways. And then you see cut into the stone. The stone is called tufa stone, which is quite soft. And it has this property that once it's exposed to oxygen, it gets very hard. So you cut it in and then it solidifies. And the poorer tombs are these that look like little shelves. And then these are open aediculi, or we can call them alcoves, where wealthier families would have their family tombs. And it's down in these catacombs that we see the very first images of Christianity. Now, I'm not saying the Christians are hiding down here. That's an old myth. But the Christians, Jews, and pagans are being buried under here. And because Christianity was illegal, they had to put these images in that were not immediately recognizable. So the art from this period, fascinating, are paintings on the walls that can be interpreted as pagan or Christian. Notice, for example, you see this character pointing up to a star. Later on, that's interpreted as the Star of David, but he's wearing a toga. This figure here, carrying a ram on his shoulder with two sheep at the bottom, has been interpreted as Orpheus. But indeed, it could be an image of the good shepherd. Here we see a woman holding a child, maybe from the cult of Mithra, or it could be the very earliest image of Jesus Christ in existence. So fascinating paintings on these, paintings on the walls underground. And finally, the last kind of decoration that you get inside these catacombs, we're going to call these pictograms or Christograms, either ones, and they're going to be inscriptions. Sometimes you see a fish or an anchor. See, that symbolism there, if you're a pagan and you're down in a catacomb and you're looking at this, you might interpret it as an anchor, a place for safety for a fisherman, or a fish could have something to do with a sea monster or perhaps a sea god or goddess. But if you think about it for a moment, they also have early Christian symbolism. The fish, for example, is in Greek, ichthus, is an anagram for Jesus Christ, Son of God and Savior. The chi rho over here on the right-hand side, chi and rho are the first two letters in Greek for the name Jesus Christ. So I love this period because it's got hidden meaning, pictograms, and these underground images of religious art. All right, well, how does this art come up from the catacombs and into churches that we'll see in Ravenna? Well, it's thanks to this guy, who I bet you recognize. His name is the Emperor Constantine. And he basically sounds the death knell of the Roman Empire, because in 313, at the Edict of Milan, he declares Christianity tolerated. It becomes legal. By 330, it was the official religion of the empire. And then what does Constantine do? He moves his imperial residence to Byzantium, which he renames Constantinople. And that's what you see here on the right-hand side. And it will remain the capital of the Eastern Empire until the year 1453. So technically, the Roman Empire is going to last from 753 BC to 1453. Wow. So with moving the capital to Constantinople, you can imagine what's going on in Rome. Well, not much. You know, it'd be like taking the government out of Washington, D.C. What's left? Even the rulers weren't any longer in Rome. There was an increasing number of emperors who based themselves in more strategic significant cities, and the city of Rome became less and less important. Yes, the Senate was there, but they had become more and more corrupt, and Rome is essentially controlled by aristocracy. So we already see the crumbling of Rome. And then the final blow are the invasions of the city of Rome itself, beginning with the Angles, the Saxons, the Franks, the Visigoths, the Vandals. Then comes Attila the Hun. I like this map as well, because you can see, look, how smart Constantine the Great was. He moved his capital over here. This is the Eastern Roman Empire. He moved it there for safety, and very few barbarians will make their way over, with the exception of the Ostrogoths. Very interesting. So these characters are coming in, and eventually Rome is going to officially fall with the Visigoths, who sack Rome in the year 410. All right, that brings us, of course, full circle, because in 410, the emperor is no longer in Rome. Where is he? You know, we're back to Honorius, who had gotten out of Dodge, thank goodness. And he was the one, of course, that got out of Rome and moved to Ravenna. And he chose very well. The city was already famous for its harbor. Here I'm showing you what's called the Port of Classis. Here on the left-hand side, I know this is, let me just zoom in a little bit. This is the city itself. Look, you can just make out that there are city walls. And look at how close we are, back up, to the Adriatic. And then here on the lower right-hand side, this is a mosaic of the Port of Classis. Let me just dwell on this for a moment. This port was already famous for its harbor, which was planned centuries before Honorius moves there by Julius Caesar. See, Julius Caesar wanted to have a base for his Roman fleet in the Eastern Mediterranean so he could make his way to the East when he needed to. Then enter in his adopted son, Augustus, and he's going to further develop this whole port town. And he really develops it as a center of naval power on the east coast of Italy, so that he could get over to further east in Byzantium if he needed to. So that's why Honorius chose it, because there was already this infrastructure set up and an important port town. Then Honorius is going to develop the harbor further. I like this image too, because you can see that there were once canals in Ravenna. I guess Ravenna must have looked much more like Venice does today. The harbor was artificially created within a lagoon. Its base is set up on stilts or piles with a capacity to shelter 250 ships. And the harbor, as you can imagine, was filled with shipbuilders, sailors, oarsmen, sailmakers, and it was connected to what will become the center of Ravenna by a man-made channel that permitted boats to go from the port right up to the main part of downtown Ravenna, if you will. So it's just perfect. And this is the remains of the old, of course, Port of Classis, just some of the structure out there in really the middle of nowhere. Now, the other reason why Honorius chose, of course, this the Ravenna was because of its relative ease to reach Constantinople. Have a look. So I just put in this line, taking us from Ravenna. So you can imagine, you can go right down the Adriatic here, past these major port towns of Ancona and Taranto. And then we zip around, going right past Crete and in and right into towards the Bosporus. So if things got dangerous, and sometimes they did, Ravenna was considered impregnable because of its large Port of Classis, and it was well served by river connections into the Po. Okay, here's the Po River, which runs right through here. I'll get in a little bit closer so you can see that. There we go. Here's Ravenna. And this is all the delta coming in from the Po River. So all this is quite fertile area. Here is the Po River, the mighty Po running through most of northern Italy. And then, of course, if things got dangerous, you can just jump on a boat and get over to Constantinople. I mean, it's actually pretty interesting. So it was a perfect situation. All right, so that's how we end up leaving Mother Rome and ending up in Ravenna. But besides the port, there was not much else in Ravenna, which turns out to be perfect because it's a tabula rasa, meaning it's a clean slate for imperial money to be invested and building up the monuments of Ravenna. And what they'll do is decorate the monuments with mosaics. I just popped up a whole series of mosaics for you to have a look at. Mosaics are the most durable of all the decorative techniques that humankind has created. It's simply the use of small colored objects to create a surface pattern. It's an ancient form and it's spread throughout the ancient world, used by architects who built temples in Mesopotamia, doors, and the Romans who used these beautiful mosaics as Roman bathhouse decorations. As you can see, some of them quite elaborate, where you can see images of the hunt, as I'm showing you. I'll get a little bit closer down here. Fascinating. That's supposed to be scenes from gladiatorial games. Moving over here, a charming cave canem. This is from the exterior of a house in Pompeii. Over here, you can see some simple geometric forms. That's actually from Greece. And a nice close-up of these mosaics, which are really beginning in the 4th century BC, are a series of pebbles and shells that will be replaced eventually by colored glass. So this colored glass, let me give you another image. There we go. Are sheets of glass that are baked into thin sheets with pigment in the glass. That's called smalt. And you cut up the pieces into small sizes, making sure that the sizes are different shapes so that you can put them together. And the pieces are called tessere. The tessere are set into wet plaster, laid down, juxtaposed at angles so they hang on to each other. And once those tessere are dry, they're going to stay inside the plaster indefinitely. Now, we have no idea who the artists were that created these beautiful mosaics in Ravenna. But as you can see, they're beautifully elaborate. Can you just make out the eye right here in the center? Look at everybody, the use of these flesh tones, pinks and lighter pinks and tans coming through here and there just to indicate the ear or the jewels in the hair. And we're at a nice close-up. Or look at this, beautiful, with the glue, with the blues in here. Blue has been used by sprinkling in lapis lazuli to create that gorgeous tessera, or real mother of pearl going across the top of this crown, and gold. So the gold is actually made of two pieces of clear glass with a piece of gold in between, so that when the light hits it, you get this kind of refraction. So the fact that because of the fall of Rome and the moving of course, the capital to Ravenna, we end up with this glorious kind of imagery. And because now Christianity is legal, it is the religion of the empire, you can no longer do images and mosaics on the floor to walk on as if you were in a Roman bathhouse, but you have to put them up on the walls of the beautiful new churches of Ravenna. Now, if you're taking notes or keep note of this in your mind, something that I find fascinating about the mosaics in Ravenna is that opposite of what we've learned in Art History 101, Stylistically, the images in Ravenna will move from naturalism to abstraction, rather than from abstract to nat. We've all learned that you start with flat, two-dimensional art, and it moves to naturalism. Well, in this case, it is actually the opposite because of the influence of Byzantium. Remember, Constantine the Great moved the capital to Constantinople. So keep that in mind, and I'll show that to you as we get through these images. Now, the thing that's so much fun about Ravenna is that the beautiful images, the mosaics, are as sparkling and interesting and colorful as the characters from late antiquity. And I wanted to start with this woman. I've already introduced you to her brother. Her brother's name was Honorius, and her name is Galla Placida, or you can pronounce it Galla Placidia. And her dates are 388 to 450. I mean, wow, this is early stuff. So there she was. She's there during the whole crumbling of the Roman Empire. And she was an unusual figure, not only in her turbulent life, but also in her relationships. And she played this key role in the development of the city of Ravenna. All right, so she was the sister of, let me remind you, here's Honorius. Their father was a guy named Theodosius. And when Honorius moved the capital to Ravenna, she didn't join him. She remained in Rome because, according to her biographer, Honorius was incestuous. So she didn't follow her brother. Instead, she stayed in Rome and in the year 408, which was not a good move because we know what happens. Alaric, the Visigoth, is going to sack Rome in 410. Here's some romantic images of that. Now, Galla Placidia was in Rome, and she, as the emperor's sister, is going to get captured and taken hostage by the Goths, where we get our word Gothic. They kept her in their camps. Apparently, they treated her quite well. Alaric, the guy you see on the left, died, and let's get rid of him, and his brother Altalphus takes over. So Altalphus ends up marrying Galla Placidia in 414 when she was 21 years old. Apparently they had a happy marriage because she was showered with gold and silver at her wedding, and they had a son just 1 year later. So she goes from being the sister of the emperor to the wife of the big barbarian. Well, Altalphus dies, and Galla Placidia makes her way to Constantinople. I wouldn't go to Ravenna either if I were her. That's where her other brother, whose name was Arcadius, was running the show. Here's Arcadius, just to give you an idea. Arcadius marries her off to a general. She's got two children, and meanwhile, Honorius dies, and she moves back to Ravenna with her children. Her husband dies, and she becomes the regent in the West. So it goes from the sister of the emperor to the queen of the barbarians, and now she is the imperial ruler of Ravenna at the time with her son and her adolescent daughter. Well, it turns out that her daughter had a taste for barbarians, just like her mom. And turns out that the daughter, Honoria, was writing love letters to the biggest barbarian of them all, Attila the Hun. Well, Galla Placidia clapped her daughter into a convent, and she never saw the light of day again. And Galla Placidia remains to us one of the most interesting characters from late antiquity. Daughter of the Roman Emperor, sister of the Roman Emperor, sister of the Roman Emperor in the East, wife of the King of the Barbarians, mother of the Roman Emperor in the West, and regent of the Western Empire. Isn't that fascinating? Galla Placidia. All right, so that's her background, and here's her monument. Ah, so beautiful. It's called the Mausoleum of Galla Placidia. I'll call it the so-called Mausoleum of Galla Placidia because she's actually not buried there. This is an interesting building. So let's just look at it architecturally. It looks a little bit strange out there in that lovely field of green grass. It was once attached to a much larger church. Therefore, it was an oratory or a little attached chapel to a church dedicated to the Holy Cross. The other thing that looks a little strange about this building is it's kind of squat. And the reason for that is, remember, Ravenna is all built on this uneven subsoil, right? Well, it's all filled with canals. And over the centuries, this building has sunken down into the subsoil. To give you an idea, if you get up close with me, you'll see that these are windows, right? Which presumably should have been much higher, and the arches much higher as you come in. Architecture, this is interesting as well. It's all made of brick, which makes perfect sense. After all, we're in a town with the Po River and the Delta. And it's quite plain on the exterior. You don't see any kind of revetment or sheathing in marble. And it's not that it was lost, even though the mausoleum dates from 425. I think it was purposeful that this thing was built with a plain exterior and built rather quickly. Remember, Ravenna was a tabula rasa, a clean slate. Therefore, the buildings are all going to date from this period from about 425 to about 525. Okay, so here it is from the exterior. Now, step inside with me. Isn't that splendid? That's the interior, friends. Wow. It's like stepping into another world. So that plain exterior really sets us up for this surprise entrance where everywhere you look, it's encrusted in beautiful mosaic. Beautiful mosaic. Now, I told you the history of mosaics. I told you that, in fact, during this period, it's Christians. You can't have these images on the floor. Hence, they go up on the walls. And what's interesting about mosaics, because of their nature, mosaics love curved spaces because they hang on to each other better. And each of these tessitae laid into the plaster, everywhere you look, there's some beautiful design. The term for that is called horror vacui, which means fear of empty places, because there's no empty place to set your eye. Let's take a walk. All right, now here we've entered in. My back is to the door, and we can see there are three sarcophagi that were brought in here at a later date. And so we're going to ignore them for now. But instead, you can see that it's a Greek cross, and there are arches, windows, and beneath the arches, you have these lunettes. Now, that's what I want to start with. This lunette shows us one of the earliest images of Christ after those pictograms I just showed you. So it's not the Cairo, it's not the fish or an anchor. Now Christ has become human, and he's shown here as a good shepherd. So let's read him. Whoever did this, and again, we have no idea who the artist was, has given us a landscape that looks rather naturalistic. We're going to move from naturalism to abstraction. Notice the way the mosaicists have been very careful to give us this treatment or the illusion that the landscape goes in and out. I mean, it's pretty convincing. Then we look immediately to the image of Christ, who's seated in contrapposto, or kind of twisted weight shift. Look at the delicate way he crosses his little sandaled feet. Notice these beautiful purple robes, and crossing across his body is his right arm, where he chucks underneath the chin these wonderful chubby little lambs. And the lambs are distributed in the landscape, varied so that they look naturalistic. Remember those lambs, because I'll remind you of them in just a little while. Christ here looks like a good shepherd. He's beardless. He's got this nimbus, where we can call it a halo, but a nimbus is more correct in the early Christian period. He could be Orpheus, couldn't he? Be sitting here taming the animals. So what you're getting here is an interesting moment of a nuancing away from pagan art into Christian art. So the Christians are borrowing from these classical motifs. Let's do another one. We turn around and we walk straight down very small space, three steps away, and we get to the next lunette, where we look up and we can see this blue starry sky. Isn't that lovely? This has been, the pattern has been traced back to patterns on beautiful carpets from Mesopotamia. They almost look like snowflakes, reattributed for the Christians to represent heaven, these blue starry sky. And then we come to this image. Here's the window. The windows inside the mausoleum of Galla Pacitti are made of alabaster, which has been thinly cut. And when the light comes in, you get this unreal golden kind of glowing feel to it. It looks otherworldly. And here we can see in this lunette, it's an image of St. Lawrence. You remember St. Lawrence? He was one of the early Christians who was martyred back in Rome. He's going off happily to his martyrdom. He said, more smoke, more fire, make it hotter, flip me, I'm done on this side. He's in fact the patron saint of bakers, strangely enough. And you can see how naturalistic the figures look. I mean, let's read this closely. He looks very vivacious with this cross over his shoulder. And then underneath the gridiron that even has wheels, so it's kind of a portable martyrdom device, you can see all this fire licking flames up and under the gridiron. Then over here on the left, everything we know about the life of Christ shown Mark, Luke, Matthew, and John. That's why I describe those images of the early Christians so carefully. And then details, getting very close up. I have to admit, this is hard to see with the naked eye, but this is one of the great things about the power of Zoom. These kind of images, I can get you in close and show you that even the careful delineation of the eye, just enjoy this. Look at the beak of the bird, the little extra red above the eyeball of the bird, how he's turned his head, whiter tessera, gray tessera, this dark green, to give you a sense of three-dimensionality. These three lines here of the white tessera just pop the edge of that fountain out towards us and give us a real sense of three-dimensionality. Or this, which almost looks like modern art, this meander form, which fools the eye into thinking that it is moving in and out of the space. And at Galla Placidia, this really lovely, again, blue starry sky, symbolic of heaven. And then straight up, the golden cross. Oh, I mean, isn't that just fabulous? And that's what you get in the earliest monuments, of course, of Ravenna. Well, let's move on. Enter in this character whose name is Theodoric, and he is a barbarian. So what happens with he's the king of what's called the Ostrogoths, which means the Goths coming in from the east. And he's going to invade Italy in 488. And basically, he conquers virtually the entire peninsula. See, look at the map of Italy. This whole area in yellow is going to be under Theodoric. And he establishes himself as king, and he rules, of course, from Ravenna. And he ushers in a real period of peace, but he committed the unforgettable sin of being an Arian. Okay, what is an Arian? When you say the word Arian, you're supposed to spit. Not Arian, like, you know, the Nazis, but Arian, A-R-I-A-N. And it's a doctrine that was taught by this guy named Arius that Christ the Son was not consubstantial with God the Father. What that means is that Christ was a man on earth and then God after he rose. Man on earth, God after he rose, not the same being like in the Nicene Creed. And I know that doesn't seem like a big deal to us, but they fought wars over this. And in fact, we have this whole kingdom of the Goths that's going to take over this whole region. And Theodoric is going to rule from Ravenna. And of course, what does he do? He builds a building. First thing he does is his palace. This is all that's left of his famous palace. in Ravenna. It's just simply a wall that stands there on one of the main streets. You just walk by and you think, what's that thing? And little do you know that it was one of the most important objects from the 5th century. Look at this palace facade with me just for a moment, because it's going to come into play in one second. Here you can see there's a series of arches. This is a big balcony where the Theodoric would come out, and then column and main arch in the center. Now everything's been stripped away, but the structure itself you can still discern quite well. Right down the street, about 50 yards away, is the church that he built as an Arian. It's called Santo Polinare Nuovo. Let's step inside. Okay. So here's the interior of Santo Polinare Nuovo. It just means new Saint Apollinare. They call it that because Saint Apollinare had been buried out in the port of Classis. And there were barbarians who were coming in to threaten the port, and they moved his body in here for safekeeping. That's why it's called Santo Polinare the New. Never mind, it's not important. Down here at the apse is a later addition that's all rococo, ignore it. But instead, I want you to look at the side walls on either side of the nave. Here, you can get a good look like this. This whole section right under the roof line, this series of mosaics were done under the terrible Arian, supposed to spit. So he comes in and does this whole series. He hires his mosaicists to do these images, which I find fascinating because on one side, on the left side, you're going to see images of Christ performing these miracles. See, he's got his hands out, he's raising Lazarus. And then down here, he's going to the calling of Peter, and he's going to walk on water. Now on the right side, you can see just two examples of moments in Christ's life that's going to lead to his crucifixion and resurrection. This is Last Supper. Everybody's leaning because they're in a seder. Down here, Kiss of Judas. Now, what's the difference, everybody? Look at the two images of Christ. Yeah, you can see clearly that on the left, he doesn't have a beard, and on the right, he does have a beard. On the left, he's performing miracles, therefore, he is like God. And on the right, he is a man making his way to his martyrdom. So an idea here is that these mosaics are reflecting this division of the nature of Christ as man and as God. I mean, wow, fascinating stuff. Here, for example, you can see also stylistically, we're starting to get a little bit more abstract. Let's do the comparison. Down below, this is the image of the Good Shepherd I just showed you. And up above, I can see Christ shown dividing up the sheep and the, what are they called? Rams, goats, excuse me. See, no beard, but he's much more frontal. Now the lambs have moved to the left and right, whereas down here, when they were more naturalistic, they were all distributed in the landscape. Who knew lambs could be so interesting? All right, now, what ends up happening is that, of course, Theodoric the Terrible Arian is going to get kicked out of Ravenna by a guy named Justinian, who I'm going to get to. And what happens? So look at this image. I hope it reminds you of the palace of Theodoric. See, there's our arches. There's the balcony where he would come out to greet the people. Behind, you can just make out this is the city of Ravenna. Behind, look at the city walls, everyone, in mosaic. They're all crenellated, very busy back there. And this is, of course, Theodoric's palace. But what's wrong with this palace? Does anybody wonder what's going on here? Take a look. Look, nobody's home. Why are those curtains open? Why is the, also these curtains who are supposed, it says palatium, which means palace, telling us that this is the palace of Theodoric. But here you can see these strange curtains that are tied up. These are kind of nifty looking mosaiced images to give you shutters, this ceremoniously pulled open curtain, but it's displaying what? Nothing. nobody's home. But if you look closely, very closely, just where these circles are coming up, if you have good eyes, you're going to make out little details such as the hand. See right there? And I can see another hand right there. And then just behind, I almost see what looks like the beginning of a head of some sort. So what's going on, everyone, is that when the next ruler comes in, he's going to carefully have his workmen chisel away any image of Theodoric or his court, and he leaves the rest of it blank. That's how serious they took this idea of the emperor who was Arian. So Theodoric is going to move out of the way and enter in the emperor Justinian. And Justinian will take care of that whole interior and add in his own images, which are much more Eastern looking. This whole procession of male martyrs, it's a gorgeous image. On the other side, the procession of female martyrs. And I guess my favorite image, and one that's quite appropriate for our season, is the adoration of the Magi who make their way to the image of Christ. Can you see that it looks more Eastern? Now we're getting abstract. The figures are elongated. Okay, why? Why is that? Because Justinian is coming over from Byzantium, which was Constantinople. Remember, he's going to be ruling the Eastern. He comes in, he has a war with the terrible Arians, and he becomes the master of this area. He's going to rule with his wife, her name is Theodora, and they're going to rule from 527 to 565. Just a few things about Justinian. He was noted for his administrative reorganization of the government. He codified Roman law. The word Justinian is where we get our word in English, justice. And he really went all out to regain the former Roman provinces that had been lost to Theodoric. So this is the period of the Goths, the kingdom of the Goths in the center. Boom, enter in Justinian, and everything you see in purple and light purple is taken back over by Byzantium. Now we've got the Byzantine Empire. And what is the capital of the Byzantine Empire in the east? Byzantium, AKA Constantinople. What is the capital of the Byzantine Empire in the west? Ravenna, of course. So interesting, this history. Now here's the monument, best known monument that belongs to this incredible period. And it's called San Vitale, and it dates 547. Exterior is unusual. It's a centralized building, something that would have been recognizable or used quite a bit in Constantinople at the time. Ignore those flying buttresses. Flying buttresses aren't used until the 13th century. They were added later, but let's step inside. Wow, that is spectacular. Again, everywhere you look, this is like nothing you've ever seen in the city of Rome. Everywhere you look are decorations and mosaics. Here is the famous mosaic series of Justinian and Theodora, horror vacui, every single inch covered in mosaic. Now Christ has changed his image to the Lamb of God, looking straight up. I can see stylized grape vines coming up with these wonderful kind of Herculean angels holding up the image of the Lamb of God. Let's get a little bit closer with his nimbus. Look at the naturalism here of the fruit. It's interesting because under this period of Justinian, it's quite abstract, but when you get down to little details such as the peaches and the pears and the vines, that's actually remains still naturalistic. Now here's Christ. He's beardless. He's looking like an Apollo figure, and he's seated on the world. In his left hand, he holds what's called the traditio legis, which is the law, and he's passing over the crown of martyrdom to San Vitale. Now I know that something supernatural is going on because I can see those rainbow colored clouds. See, all of this is symbolic. You read it almost through shorthand. More images, beautiful material that's used here. Here's our four gospels that I talked about earlier. How do I know that's Luke and Mark and John and Matthew? Because their names are written in their books and their symbolism is right up above. This wonderful roaring lion, I have to admit, is my very favorite in the mosaics. Natural, I mean, can almost hear this wonderful creature roaring. But the most famous parts of the San Vitale, and one that I know most of you studied in 101 art history, is the image of Justinian. And here we can see Justinian in the center of the composition, showing us his military might as well as his Christianity. Reading from right to left, I can see this character here holding an incense holder. Then we can see another member of the clergy who has a tonsure holding a jeweled book. Then I can see the Bishop Maximiliano. He's got the jeweled cross in front of him. Look at that image. This is everybody, this is 525, and that looks to me like a portrait. See this guy here who looks like he needs a shave? That guy's name is Giuliano Argentario. He's the one who bankrolled the building itself. He's also the one who paid for the Hagia Sophia in Istanbul. He was a silver merchant, and that's why we see this similarity. And there, of course, is Justinian with his eyes wide open. He has his royal spina on his shoulder, and he's carrying a basket, which represents, of course, the body of Christ. His military is way over here on the left-hand side, and I hope you recognize it. There's the Chi Rho, the first and second letter of Greek for the word Christ. All that Christian symbolism that we studied in the beginning is now coming home to roost here in Ravenna. This is, of course, facing her husband is Theodora. Theodora was one of the most intriguing women of late antiquity. Let me give you a close-up. Here she is. We know a lot about her from her author, whose name is Procopius. He wrote about her in his secret history. He tells us that her father was a bear keeper and a trainer. Her mother was a dancer and an actress. And Procopius said that Theodora worked as a... she worked in a brothel, and she was known as doing a very good shimmy, which attracted, of course, the eye of Justinian. She caught the eye of the emperor. He married him, and according to Procopius, she helped her husband rule. She was very shrewd. She had good political strategies and participated in all the decisions that her husband made, and she really ran him by his halo. So a wonderful image of this woman, Theodora. All right, the last image I'll show you in these last few minutes takes us to the end of this reign of Ravenna as being the capital of the West, and that's out here at the Port of Classis, bringing it full circle at this church, which is called Santo Apollinare in Classe. Santo Apollinare at the Port of Classe. And we step inside, and that's what we see. The apse mosaic showing us Saint Apollinare presenting us paradise. The building itself is so beautiful. Look at the material used here. This is called Proconesian marble. It's gorgeous waves of gray and white. These capitals are called wind-blown capitals. At one time, the entire church was sheathed in this. Much of that was taken away by a guy named Sigismondo Malatesta to help Alberti decorate the interior of his church, but that's another story. But we end with this image, which is hypnotizing. Santo Apollinare here presenting us with paradise. Tell us paradise because I can see all these beautiful plants and trees. Also, we can see our lambs are back again, the 12 lambs representing the 12 apostles, or perhaps the 12 tribes of Israel. Up above, let me give you a close-up of Santo Polinare. You can see this kind of a gesture that he's in is called an orant gesture. It's the way the early Christians prayed. These nice chubby lambs, compare those lambs to, of course, the lambs that we've met earlier, and we've become as abstract as we can get. In the middle, we can see Christ now turning into what's called a pantocrator, an all-knowing, omnipotent Christ, bearded, judgmental, just three-quarters of his body, holding the jeweled book. We've come a long way from that naturalistic good shepherd. And then here above Santo Polinare, a beautiful jewel cross representing victory with the Alpha and the Omega on the right and left-hand side, and Salvus Mundi, savior of the world. The jewel cross is the image of victory in this case. And this brings us to the culmination of Ravenna as the capital of the Western Empire. And it's shortly after that, in 584, the Lombard invasions will come in, and that will be the end of Ravenna in the West. Ooh, we got through it, David. I got through 500 years of very, it's an exciting, exciting place and filled with history and filled with beautiful, beautiful objects.
Well, Elaine, I have to tell you, as usual, you have enlightened us in new ways. We are, of course, touring through a place where I think not many of us have spent a lot of time thinking about its sort of historical background. I want to let everybody know that we do have time for a few questions. If you have any questions or comments, please post them in the chat or the Q&A, and our producer for today, Laura Fogarty, will help me to guide these questions over to Elaine. But Elaine, I have a couple of questions I'm going to ask before anyone else does, if you don't mind. So, of course, there's sort of the move away from Ravenna. What happens in the ensuing centuries? Does Ravenna sort of become a relatively minor state in the Italian cityscape landscape of the later 1000s and into the 1200s, 1300s.
Right. The Lombards take over in 584, and basically Ravenna becomes a backwater. Also, they had some problems with not keeping up on the canals, so it became malaria infested. It doesn't really come back on the scene again until around the 13th century, when a family called the Da Polenta family become the Grand Signori of Ravenna. And little known fact, the Da Polenta family hosted Dante. So when Dante got kicked out of Florence, he wanders around Northern Italy and he ends up living in Ravenna, hosted by the Da Polenta family. He's actually buried in Ravenna.
Interesting.
Yeah, really interesting.
So I have a question. You of course showed us the patterns and the more natural scenes in the mosaics, but back to the patterns. Are these patterns generally descended from the Greeks, or are these part and parcel of the artistic patrimony of the earlier Roman Empire?
Mm-hmm. So in the first one I showed you, the Mausoleum of Galla Placidia and the Santo Polinare Nuovo under Theodoric, those patterns can be traced to the Romans, the whole kind of waning of the classical era. Then afterwards with San Vitale and Santo Polinare in Classe, those are all Eastern. The one exception to that, David, is that blue starry sky. That seems to be Eastern, which was, really interesting, don't you think?
Really fantastic.
Yeah, so classicizing to abstract.
Amazing.
Good question.
So we have a question coming from Clement Brown, a good friend of ours. He's asking, have you read the book Elaine by Judith Herring?
Yeah, I just got it. I thought it was delightful. That's who asked that question, David?
That's Clement Brown.
Okay, Clement, I just read that book, Clement, over the summer. And that's where I got all that good material on Theodora doing the shimmy and being the bear keeper's daughter. I thought it was delightful.
Excellent. Elaine, anything else you want to share with us?
Let's
Until
see.
Next time?
Until next time, if anyone's interested, I'm going to be doing a talk tomorrow night on my presentation. I'll be doing the image of Christ over the centuries. And then next week, I'm going to do the Nativity in Art to celebrate Christmas. So happy holidays to everybody. And David, thank you so much for inviting me. It's really always a pleasure.
Well, it's always great to see you, Elaine. And I can tell you, everyone in our audience joined our production today because they like and enjoy you so much. So it's great to have you with us once again. Thanks to you. And I also want to thank Laura Fogarty, one of our museum team members who produced today's program. Hope everybody has a wonderful holiday. And we look forward to seeing you at the museum very, very soon.
Grazie mille. Ciao, everybody. Ciao, ciao, ciao.